Welcome to the Presbyterian Journey. I'm the Reverend Lucus Levy Keppel, and I'm so glad to have you with me today. This is the sixth part of our Presbyterian Journey, and like a dog sled cruising over the tundra, we can't stay anywhere for too long. So if anything we discuss today catches your attention, I encourage you to leave a comment or reach out to your pastor, who can give you a much more in-depth resource. Last time we spoke about the New World Presbyterian Churches and what it was like in Philadelphia trying to organize this new church. This week we're on a ship to Juneau in the Alaska Territory, ready to see what mission work will look like in this chilly landscape. But like 1 Corinthians 14:40 reminds us, let's do all things decently and in good order. We need to talk about organization in the church. The most important councils of the Presbyterian Church are the presbyteries. Anything that is not explicitly handled in the congregation or at General Assembly falls to the presbytery to sort out. Remember, presbyteries are regional collections of congregations, something akin to a state in the church, though they're a lot smaller than the 50 states we're used to talking about in the secular world. After the passage of the new form of government, also called NFOG, in 2011, presbyteries have become a lot more autonomous in their structure than they were previously. Each presbytery now has the freedom to experiment with different committee structures as long as they fulfill all of the duties that are called for in the Book of Order. What are those duties? Let's go through them. Presbyteries are responsible for organizing, overseeing, and dissolving congregations, ordaining, installing, and removing ministers of word and sacrament, maintaining ecumenical and interfaith partnerships, authorizing the celebration of communion and baptism, training and educating commissioned pastors, communicating with General Assembly, synods, and congregations. Each presbytery is made up of an equal number of ruling elders, commissioned from sessions of each congregation, and teaching elders, both actively serving a church and those that are honorably retired. Usually, a presbytery elects a moderator to serve a one-year term from among its members, and most presbyteries alternate between ruling elders and teaching elders each year. While there is no longer a required organization, a typical presbytery is organized with some paid staff, including a stated clerk, a general presbyter, and an office administrator. The stated clerk is responsible for taking minutes of meetings, receiving correspondence, and being the go-to person for polity and procedural questions, assisting the elected moderator in running presbytery meetings. General or executive presbyters serve as an organizational connector, working as a go-between of the congregations and being a pastor to the pastors. Then, presbyteries usually have committees to oversee the various duties that are needed within the presbytery bounds. Traditionally, these include the Committee on Preparation for Ministry, encouraging inquirers and candidates to ministry and guiding them along the path to ordination, or discouraging them as needed. The Commission on Ministry, or COM, is responsible for congregational oversight, installing new pastors, and helping to establish administrative commissions to sort out times when things don't go according to plan. If the COM and the Administrative Commission can't work through it, or it's clear that there have been major violations of polity, the Permanent Judicial Commission, PJC, will be called up to investigate and help provide restitution and reconciliation as appropriate. Mission, nominating, and other committees and commissions are set up as needed, too. This is certainly not an exhaustive list, since the current structure differs so widely from one presbytery to another. Now that we understand the basics of a presbytery, we're ready to look at mission. Specifically, what even does mission mean? Like most Christians, we Presbyterians listen to Jesus' words in the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. Mission today is about helping people become disciples, of showing God's love and care in action. It's about education and providing for the needs of those struggling to get by, just as the early church helped feed and clothe the hungry. At the denominational level, the Presbyterian Mission Agency, PMA, works directly with people in need and with nonprofits in the U.S. and around the world. Its four sections begin with compassion, peace, and justice, overseeing disaster assistance, hunger programs, peacemaking, and connections with the United Nations and with the public through the Office of the Public Witness that advocates on behalf of systemic changes needed to help people. Then the Racial, Ethnic, and Women's Ministries group works to advocate on behalf of underrepresented people in the denomination, offering scholarships and advocacy platforms and safe spaces to speak and discuss the issues that arise together. Theology, Formation, and Evangelism oversees programs like the 1001 New Worshiping Communities, the Company of New Pastors, Publishing Corporation, Young Adult Ministries, and so on. Lastly, World Mission focuses on supporting world mission workers, once called missionaries, and young adult volunteers, or the YAV, YAV program, placing young adults in ministry situations around the world, from Northern Ireland to Indonesia. Of course, all of this mission work today is built on the shoulders of those who came before, both in their successes and for their missteps. For example, the Reverend Dr. Sheldon Jackson was a pastor in the 19th century who desperately wanted to be a missionary, but he was told by the denomination that he was too sickly. Instead, he established churches in Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Oklahoma, and then used the expanding rail system to establish churches at an incredible pace, as frequently as one church a day in some cases. After the U.S. purchased the Alaska Territory from Russia, Jackson worked with an interdenominational group of Christians to divide up the territory for the mission field. Their idea was that it would help the Alaska natives not be overwhelmed with all of these different choices if each denomination had a section of the territory to work in. This plan was called the Alaska Comity Plan, and it designated areas of the territory for specific denominations to send evangelists and mission workers. While it was followed for mission work, as American Christians moved to the territory and later the state for the various gold rushes, they refused to leave their own denominations behind. And so many different denominations now have churches throughout Alaska, though the village churches tend to still follow that comity plan. Jackson's plan is not likely to be repeated due to its inherent colonialism, but his work at establishing churches and encouraging mission workers to think of new solutions, well, that's still very important. Jackson did have one other claim to fame in Alaska. After noting that settlers were killing off caribou too swiftly to be replaced, he brought reindeer in from Scandinavia to help the hungry Alaska Native population. Reindeer herding is still practiced in the state today and is still a valued resource in the area. Presbyterians have long been supporters of education through the Sunday school movement, which originally was designed to teach people, including former slaves, to read and write, and the establishment of universities and teaching hospitals. But few have the reputation of Susan Law McBeth, who was known as a theological seminary in herself. She set up a school for educating Native Americans in Idaho, with an emphasis on literacy, domestic activities, and ministries. It was also her work that established a tradition of annual camp meetings, where people from wide-ranging areas would come together to live and worship together for weeks at a time. McBeth did this at a time when women were not allowed to be ordained, but still obviously craved the opportunity to minister to people in need. Another woman of faith at this time was Donaldina Cameron, sometimes still referred to as the Angry Angel of Chinatown. At age 25, she became superintendent of the Presbyterian home in San Francisco, where she cared for immigrant women. Much of her duty involved protecting Chinese women from being forced into service. She advocated on their behalf at a time when people of Chinese descent could not legally become citizens of the United States. However, she did require that women staying with her convert to Christianity, a practice of forced conversion that we do not do today, and for which have offered apologies and, in some cases, reparations. While Presbyterian mission work thrived within the United States, U.S. Presbyterians also sent mission workers to places throughout the globe. For instance, the Reverend Dr. William Morrison and the Reverend William Sheppard were mission workers sent to the Congo, who had lived with people there and translated the Bible into the Baluba language. Additionally, while they were printing Bibles, they also printed newspapers protesting the abuse of natives at the hands of Belgian officials. Their work was widely reprinted and eventually actually forced King Leopold of Belgium to cede control of the Congo back to the native people. For all of the flaws of mission work, we know that it is important to do the best we can and trust that through God we will find better ways of serving each other as time goes on. That's going to wrap up this week's episode, but come back next week as we go to New York in the early 20th century and tackle this fundamentalist-modernist debate. If this series has been helpful to you, please leave a like or a comment below, and may your Presbyterian journey bring you wisdom.